thank you all for coming. We're really happy to see so many people here on a Thursday evening. We have a great panel of professors here that are going to transform the way you guys think about legal education. This is the second event in our three-day symposium called Law School Matters, Reassessing Legal Education Post-Ferguson. For those of you who weren't at the lunch, it's put on by Students for Inclusion. We're a new student group that formed last year. And basically our mission is kind of to assist Harvard in continuing to be reflective of how diverse its student body is and ensure that we're all being proactive about making sure that's inclusive to all different types of voices and experiences, both in and outside the classroom. And a lot of that has to do with, I think, what we learn and how we learn. So we wanted to put together kind of a mock class teach-in with a few excellent professors and kind of maybe give a slightly tweaked view of how we generally learn some of the cases that we learn one a year. So the structure is going to be Professor Crenshaw is going to start with a few remarks, then get into some cases, and each of the professors has a case that they are going to be focusing on along with kind of their general remarks about the idea of how they approach their legal education. So we'll start with Professor Crenshaw.
So thank you, Rena, and to all of the students who organized this amazing event. I have to say, it really is an honor. I sometimes say that as you have to when you give speeches, but this time I really mean it. An honor to be here, and especially at this moment, which I think is an important time to renew critical thinking about social power and hierarchy and the law. I'll confess to you, I struggled a bit about what I might offer to amplify the theme, law, reassessing legal education post-Ferguson. Even more challenging was Rena's encouragement this afternoon for you all to come see how we might teach a class. So that kind of created a bit of mind freeze for me. So I typically talk about race and pedagogy, drawing from an article that I wrote shortly after I graduated from this institution. It was like 2 years out, and in it I reflected on the experience of being a student of color in a conventional law school classroom. And by conventional, I mean one in which race is not signified as something that will be discussed or interrogated. And the assumption is you're supposed to leave your race at the door, as it were. And in such a classroom, I argued that students of color might experience something that I called objectification, subjectification, and alienation. They were just words I grabbed to describe some experiences. Each reflected ways that race contributed to the various dimensions of being racialized in a law school classroom. And you could experience that whether race was being ignored, whether it was being occasionally invoked, or when it was being actually centered in the discourse. So as I explained there, these dynamics typically involve self-objectification. That happens when a topic turns to something like, say, stop and frisk policies border investigations of individuals who look like they might be immigrants, or where geographic discordance or a race suspect description prompts the question of whether a police officer can pull you over. And the challenge for the student of color who may have last weekend been pulled over by the police under precisely these premises has to demonstrate her ability to engage these legal rules without reference to her personal relationship or vulnerability to these very rules. Now, the costs of such rules, of course, are always somewhere in the consciousness of the student, but that student who fails to heed the implicit norm that you're not supposed to say anything about your personal vulnerability to these rules, if you don't heed that warning, you risk being shown as a person who either lacks analytical legal skill or, more importantly, the temperament to be a lawyer, to set aside one's emotions as it's framed, and just to engage in legal analysis. Now, occasionally one is given license to step into the role of testimonial. It might be a case, it might be a whole day, Sometimes it could be a whole week where the topic really requires the voice of the other to offer some kind of personal observation about the said rule. Now, the thing is, this is clearly outside of the basic function of the instruction. It's rather like taking a field trip in class to the other side of town. It is the enrichment that diversity says students of color offer to everyone else in the classroom. And it's indicated that this is enrichment by the fact that everyone else suddenly stops taking notes because we all know this is not going to be on the exam. Now, the third experience I call alienation. It captures the classroom in which legal problems of subordinate communities are rarely, if ever, studied. In fact, the line between standard courses and specialty courses is that questions pertaining to property, estates, contracts, and other matters are separated out when those issues are issues, say, of poor people. Much of poverty law might be considered to be the aggregation of all of these other areas on those who are poor. One could go on and identify the difference between the standard courses and the specialty courses as those moments where the subjects are those as experienced by poor people or Native Americans or women or LGBTQ people. But as this is a digression from the principal discussion here, I simply want to say that I begin all of my courses with the acknowledgement that my teaching objectives are informed by efforts to recall these experiences that I had as a student and circumvent them in the classroom. Now, these are just objectives. They are points of departure. They're not points of arrival. I'm sure that even in my classes, there are moments when students experience each of these. But they are my hope is that some part of how I engage some of the material is to minimize those moments. So, assume that we are in said classroom. I have signaled an intention to facilitate dialogue informed by these challenges. So the theme of today is Ferguson, and it invites a further reflection about the shifting ways that law might be said to be involved in the project of constructing, rationalizing, and insulating racial power. Now, one seeks to understand in order to think through the ways that law might be harnessed for different purposes, or the ways that the ideology that mediates prevailing legal debates might be identified for us to more deeply interrogate these ideologies. Now, among the most significant themes discussed today is the presumed disconnection or lack of connection between the legal protections associated with equal protection today and that which prevailed a half century ago or in the 19th century. The common point of departure, post-racialism, builds from its constitutional sire, which is colorblindness. Now, as the current Supreme Court continues to converge around colorblindness as potentially the mediating principle of the Equal Protection Clause, the legal genealogy of this colorblindness and all of its analytics becomes a preoccupation for many students. A key assumption that circulates with colorblindness is that it has long been a beacon of constitutional equality, offered but rejected in Plessy versus Ferguson. So by these measures, if this is the line that you take on colorblindness, Plessy is light years away from our current constitutional order. And the current embrace of colorblindness is the embodiment of progress. So that's sort of the standard line about colorblindness. So I want to walk through an engagement with Plessy in order to challenge this idea of the long and always forward-moving constitutional maturation of race jurisprudence. Now, let's begin, and you have to pretend now that we're in a classroom, and I do sometimes have a PowerPoint. So I begin with a visualization of the various parties involved in Plessy. That would include Justice Brown, Justice Harlan, and I don't say it, but I have a picture of Homer Plessy. So I ask students, who is who? I know they think, why are you asking us a question about what the different parties look like? But I say, bear with me, there's a point here. Invariably, students fail to identify Homer Plessy's photograph. Phenotypically, Homer Plessy is white. He is, by the terms of the day, an octoroon. As the court says, Negro blood is not discernible in him. Now, this recognition then raises what is in many ways the second question in Plessy. The fact that there were at least two central arguments in the case is often forgotten. Now, we're familiar with the challenge that the case is mostly known for, namely whether the state of Louisiana's efforts to effect segregated rail cars constituted a denial of equal protection, specifically race discrimination against its colored citizens. The second argument is less apparent, and this is what I use the photograph to interrogate. Pausing for just a moment, what is the second argument that Homer Plessy is making? Not the argument that all those who are categorized as African Americans may be arguing that they're denied equal protection because they are forced to sit in a separate car, but another argument that Plessy is making. So we talk, and people come up, they try to. Eventually, someone says something along the lines that Plessy is being denied his right to whiteness, right? He looks white, phenotypically. He engages in the community in ways that performs whiteness. So effectively, what Plessy is trying to make is an argument that he has been unconstitutionally deprived of the reputational value of whiteness. Now, in this argument, Plessy is raising the constitutionality of what we call asymmetrical racial systems. There's a term for it. It's called hypodescent, in which blackness is an all-encompassing racial category and whiteness is an exclusionary category. In other words, Plessy's genealogy, one black great-grandparent, defines him as non-white, while his predominant whiteness does not define him as non-black. Moreover, his social standing, his education, and the variety of other accoutrements of whiteness do nothing to counteract the metaphor of tainted black blood. So you can have 7/8 white blood, that does not make you white, but you can have 1/8 black blood by law, and that makes you black. Now, on this particular question, the majority simply produced a circular argument, one in which I might ask the students, how can Plessy argue that he's been deprived of something when the law defines him as not that thing, right? What is the response to that? Well, the response was the court's response. Namely, you cannot be deprived of the right of whiteness if you are not, in fact, white. So this is a repudiation of the effort to subject a racial system of categorization to any kind of constitutional rulemaking. That's a stance that has only recently been revisited and only somewhat at the margins. I often ask my students, if the fairy godmother of constitutional law, let's call her Geneva Crenshaw, along the lines of Derek Bell's fictional character, if she could grant one of Plessy's wishes, which would it have been? Which argument would have done the most in deconstructing white supremacy? So students frequently debate whether white supremacy could have been sustained if the logics of hypodescent had been subjected to constitutional rules. One might, however, consider, and I should say most students, partly because we're in a sort of anti-essentialist moment, make the argument that, well, if he could have won something, he should have won the argument that, you know, race is socially constructed, this is a social construction growing out of white supremacy, so that would be the more fundamental blow to white supremacy. And to that, I asked them just to consider the case of Brazil, where there's no juridical racial categories. There's been no formal system of segregation. There's a large mixed race population, yet blackness remains deeply stigmatized and racial stratification along racial lines is clearly visible, as much there as if here. So moving on to the principal argument, does segregation contravene the protections of the 14th Amendment? To this, the question turns on its reasonableness. So, we discuss, is segregation reasonable? The court frames reasonableness in this way. Was the law meant to annoy and oppress, or was it designed as a reasonable measure to accommodate peaceful and orderly social interaction. Custom was marshaled to help determine whether the law was reasonable. If it was customary, the assumption is it was reasonable. If it was not customary, or if it was oppressive, it was assumed that it was not customary. So here we debate the reasonableness of the statute. However, the question leads to an uncomfortable recognition that if reasonableness is defined as the opposite of annoying and oppressing, and the embodiment of customary relations helps define it as reasonable, then Plessy's argument weakens. The either-or nature of the question denies that laws intended to embody customary relationships to even maintain good order might at the same time annoy and oppress. So you could have customary law designed to maintain good order, that good order being one of annoyance and oppression. These two things can actually happen at the same time. The question might be from whose vantage point and what version of history is elevated to help think about that. So students talk about whether or not segregation was really customary or not, whether it was really simply a new imposition at the end of Reconstruction, in part which it was. But beyond that, however, is the question of whether the 14th Amendment intends to be discordant with that history. Did it constitute a fundamental break, a fundamental reestablishment of the baseline? Or was it merely a post-cop imposition of state rulemaking? Which one is it? So we discuss what it means to have a discordant moment in which earlier baselines, points of departure, is broken, and those in which those earlier baselines are seen as being consistent. Now, the crux of the court's opinion comes down to a distinction between civil equality and social equality. The 14th Amendment, the court tells us, could not have been intended to bring about social equality. And to that, there was considerable agreement. The real issue was whether a law requiring the separation of the races fell on the civil side of the line, which everybody agreed the 14th Amendment guaranteed, or the social side of the line, which most people agreed it did not guarantee. So the answer was that it did not fall on the civil side of the line. But the real issue is the analysis that the court used to argue that segregation was perfectly consistent with civil equality. And here's where we have the court's first effort to invoke a symmetrical approach equal protection analysis. Here's the question. Were blacks and whites treated symmetrically by segregation? The answer to that is what? Yes or no? No. Okay, that is what we think. The court obviously disagreed with us. So the question is, how could they come to an agreement that segregation was symmetrical? Well, it's kind of easy. Blacks couldn't sit in white cars. Whites couldn't sit in black cars. There's your symmetry. Both races are equally disabled from occupying the other's car. So that's civil equality. That satisfies the Equal Protection Clause. Now, we're all uncomfortable about that. Why are we uncomfortable about that? What seems not right about the idea that symmetrical disability from sitting in each other's cars answers the question about whether segregation is, in fact, an asymmetrical system? What seems to be missing from that? Everybody said, you gave me the right answer from contemporary doctrine, so you must have a sense about what's missing. What doesn't seem right about the asymmetrical argument? Well, let me try some. Does the message of segregation, what it embodies, is that symmetrical or not? No, right? So it's a message of racial inferiority. Do we think that the actual conditions of the car, the material realities underlying segregation, do we think those are likely symmetrical? Probably not. Do we think that the way segregation actually shapes social competition, for recognition, for social capital, for any number of the other things that social interaction actually provides? Do we think that people are similarly situated in competition when they're subject to segregation? No. So it seems as though there's a long list of actual societal dynamics that are associated with the embodiment of segregation's asymmetries. The problem is that the court has defined all of these aspects as social. They're all part of the social order, and therefore all the asymmetry in the world does not encroach upon the civil dimension of segregation, right? So at the end of the day, the court can walk away with the notion that as long as this symmetrical disability is part of segregation, all this other stuff doesn't make a difference. Now, of course, the court opined that segregation need not be a permanent status attributable to Negroes. That in the by and by, they said, they might be able to prove their societal value. But until then, Plessy's demand would be seen as one essentially of preferential treatment. He's asking for racial capital that he and his group have not yet earned. Now, it is into this arena that Justice Brown threw Plessy's request for social equality, in a space where the very arrangements that Plessy was challenging, namely segregation, thoroughly structured any ability for Negroes to ever prove themselves to be the equal of whites. So how does one prove social value when the entire competition is already structured in a way that symbolizes, constructs, and insulates your inequality? So the idea that there's some kind of societal competition that is transparent and not already constructed by segregation is the fantasy of Plessy versus Ferguson. Now, Justice Harlan dissented, in effect, arguing that the Constitution is colorblind, knows no race. Now, this is what's elevated. It's still a passage that's quoted by the Supreme Court to argue the inherent rightness of colorblindness as our constitutional values. They often fail to quote the sentence that comes right before that, which is, and now I'm paraphrasing, the white man is supreme, and he will continue to be as long as he holds true to his great heritage. Whites are in no danger, effectively, from blacks. So colorblindness was not at this point offered as a method for deconstructing white supremacy. Colorblindness was offered as being perfectly consistent with the goal of maintaining white supremacy. So with colorblindness thus dislodged from the mantle of this is the ultimate tool for dismantling white supremacy, cannot we retire the entire case to the 19th century, burying it by Brown versus Board of Education? Now, I've already revealed to you that my goal is to draw the links between the past and the present, and now I can only do so in broad strokes. So let's choose a case. Let's choose Richmond versus Croson, an affirmative action case in which the court for the first time applied strict scrutiny to affirmative action programs due to their interpretation that these programs embody racial classifications. For those of you who don't recall, less than 1% of all of Richmond City contracts managed to find their ways into businesses owned by minority contractors. So Richmond modeled a set-aside program requiring primary contractors to set aside subcontracts, 30% of them to minority business enterprises. The court repudiated the program, highlighting the absence of symmetrical treatment, according to Justice O'Connor. So upholding the claim that the Constitution demands black and whites to be treated the same, Justice O'Connor locates this similar treatment in the symmetrical functioning of colorblindness itself. That symmetry, to paraphrase Plessy again, is found in the fact that neither blacks nor whites will enjoy government benefits on the basis of race. Colorblindness ensures the civil equality in 1986 in the same way that the disability of cross-racial car sitting did in Plessy. Now, you all will be quick to note, just as you did in Plessy, that this superficial symmetry does little to address the yawning asymmetries between blackness and whiteness, and more broadly, whiteness and non-whiteness, particularly when it comes to contracting opportunities in Richmond. Richmond, Virginia, the cradle of the old Confederacy, in a city that attempted to annex suburbs to forestall the moment that African Americans would become the majority in the city council. A city that was no stranger to the federal courts for its intransigence in matters of race. Obviously, the asymmetries pertaining to being black or white were tremendously significant in a place like that in efforts to understand the differential access to contracting dollars. Now, as against the very likely scenario that a city that discriminated in all these other areas was somehow not discriminating and open to minority contractors so that the dearth of them had nothing to do with the city, kind of unlikely. But Justice O'Connor opined that the societal discrimination that we might be worried about, all of these conditions and dynamics that reflect a history and pattern of white supremacy, was not correctable within the scope of the 14th Amendment unless the actual discrimination could be identified. Now, what fell outside the scope of civil equality was in this unregulated social sphere, one in which she opined individual initiative, choice, natural talent were possible factors that contributed to the dearth of minority contractors. So again, in the same way that Plessy opined that Plessy sought a social equality through an effective handout, the Crozen opinion suggested that the city council in Richmond also sought to create equal outcomes by simply taking opportunities from white contractors and handing them over to minority ones. As O'Connor famously noted, there was little evidence of how many minority businesses actually even existed, a consequence perhaps of societal discrimination, but precisely because of this, it was not correctable through affirmative action. Now, again, her requirement of proof of discrimination was like Plessy Court's proof of social equality. It was also a virtual impossibility, a road to nowhere. Like the presumed neutrality of segregation in Plessy, O'Connor's opinion seemed to disregard the operation of the contracting and property system, a system in which the normal operation of preferences and advantages ensured that once it was set up, it would continue to function in exactly the same way, legally and with the full authority of the state. The challenge that the city of Richmond undertook was to unlock the systemic cartel that the contracting institution constituted. It was thus no answer to say that the case was not ripe until it was proved that there were in fact minority contractors who were qualified and discriminated against, when the very system that Richmond was trying to change was to remove the conditions that had prevented minority business contractors from coming into existence in the first place. So both the segregation rationalized in Plessy and the contracting system that was rationalized in Crozen were presented as legally neutral, the problem being that the courts had to refuse to permit any interference with this underlying system, at least interference on the basis of race. In both instances, the legal system itself, and the Supreme Court in particular, was acting to constitute that system that they claimed they were only observing. The rules that determine what the legitimate scope of discrimination was in the first place, and through permission to proceed with an apparatus whose distributive outcomes were predictable and largely predetermined. Now, if we were in a class, our discussion would go on to reflect upon the baselines in both instances, revealing how the presentation of integration in Plessy and affirmative action in Crozen as preferences relies on the legitimacy of the underlying baseline. Here, existing rights and entitlements in Crozen, in Plessy, the custom and tradition, and police power. Arguably, these were precisely the baselines that were up for grabs in the first and the second Reconstruction. So these cases are about more than whether these preferences can be considered to be constitutional. But instead, these cases are about whether they are preferences at all. Earlier cases such as Green versus Newquay County opened up the possibility that the relevant baselines would not be existing rights and entitlements, but instead a baseline that is informed by a society in which white supremacy had not shaped society at large. As such, the requirement that that white supremacy in, say, school segregation be dismantled root and branch would not be seen as interventionist or preferential, but instead a corrective effort to disengage the existing system from its unearned privileges and power. Now, I would, to lighten the mood at this point, play an animated video that challenges the idea that race-conscious efforts to remove obstacles are preferential. I would also lighten the mood a little more with examples of past baselines rooted in, for example, slavery. So, for example, a slavery baseline makes running away a criminal act of theft. It makes refusing to work an actual disease called drapetomania. It makes advocating against slavery sedition. A different baseline, rooted in, say, freedom, would call running away liberty, right? Refusing to work without pay, a strike, and advocacy for freedom, the crux of democracy. What a new baseline might look like that would frame today's issues like stop and frisk, police shootings, defunding of the public sphere, massive incarceration of dispossessed people, that is the creative challenge of critical thinking today. And that will be the subject of our next class. Thank you.
What I'm going to do today is sort of it's at the other end of the telescope from what Kim just did. It's great to be performing with you, Kim. So it would be something like this. I'm very preoccupied with the idea that the first year curriculum in contracts, property, and torts, and the way in which most of the faculty, this is an attack on my colleagues, teach contracts, property, and torts, turns out to have complicated messages or ideological implications, which are, from my point of view, not good. Without calling them reactionary, they are, from the point of view of an anti-subordination program for education, they are regressive. So the basic thing about this claim is that it's a claim at a pretty low down micro level about the way the sequence of cases unfolds and the way the cases are presented by teachers, to some extent as a result of the way case books are constructed, but also as a result of the way the current dominant mainstream tendencies in teaching basic first year questions limit and constrict what gets discussed in class. With respect to cases, in classes that are devoted to conveying legal doctrine. So what this is about is classes that are understand themselves as teaching you contracts or property and torts, bodies of law with thousands of rules that you're supposed to be learning. The idea is that in that process, something more than the teaching of rules goes on. It's not true that you're just being taught rules, just rules, rules, rules. You're being taught policy. But the argument is the way you're taught policy suppresses racial and gender dimensions and class, very much class dimensions of doctrine. That is the implication and consequences for gender, race, class of what the rules are is obscured by the way that they're taught. And now that very abstract illustration, I want to claim this happens at the micro level, so I'm going to deal with a case which is a standard, which I don't know actually how many case books it's in. Most case books have an intentional torts section in which today intentional torts is very limited number of cases. It's usually a relatively small part of the case book, and most of it is devoted to a kind of listing of classical torts and defenses to classical torts. So I taught for many years using Richard Epstein's casebook, because although Richard Epstein is a very serious far-right conservative, his very politicization made his casebook a better casebook, because he understood himself to be engaged in right-wing battle with the liberals, and that was great. That made the casebook often assault the liberal position in a way that was absent in most torts casebooks. But this case, I'm just going to now describe the case and then a way of teaching the case. And the case is called Koblen versus Kennedy's Inc. And I'm going to read his statement of the facts, and then I'm going to read the holding, and then I'm going to read the two snippets of policy, and then I'm going to suggest what would be left out if you stuck to that as a student learning law in the first year. So here's the, so very important, by the way, to me it's very important in teaching property and contracts to torts to always say what the court and the date is. So this case is decided in the Massachusetts Supreme Judicial Court in 1971. And I would say that it's very important for the students to understand that in 1971, the Massachusetts Supreme Judicial Court is one of the most liberal courts in the country, and it's very influenced by the Warren Court, which is just disappearing. The Warren Court is disappearing at the very moment that this case is decided, but it's still very, very influential. And the Massachusetts Court, that is, this is the context. The plaintiff, a 70-year-old man, 5 feet 4 inches tall, and dressed in a woolen shirt, top coat, and hat, was shopping in defendant's store. Around his neck, the plaintiff wore an ascot, a little scarf. He had previously purchased in Filene's, another department store. Well, this is downtown Boston, by the way. There, those were big department stores in downtown Boston. While trying on a sports coat, the plaintiff took off his ascot and put it into his pocket. He purchased the coat, left it downstairs for alterations, and as he was leaving the store, took the ascot out of his pocket and put it on again. At that moment, the defendant Goss, an employee of Kennedy's, quote, loomed up, quote, unquote, in front of the plaintiff, demanded that he stop and explain where he'd gotten the ascot. As approximately 8 to 10 people looked on, the plaintiff agreed to return with Goss to the store. On the way up the stairs, the plaintiff experienced chest and back pains and had to stop several times. By the way, it's for me, I mean, I'm 72 years old, so I actually identify not with Kennedy's, the store, but with Kennedy, the 70-year-old. So on the way up, so he experienced chest and back pains and had to stop several times. When they reached the second floor, the salesman who had sold plaintiff the sports coat told Goss that the ascot was indeed the plaintiff's. The plaintiff was so upset by the incident that he required the attention of the store's nurse and was consequently hospitalized and treated for a, quote, myocardial infarct, unquote. The jury awarded $12,500 of damages for false imprisonment, and the defendant appealed. So this is the tort of false imprisonment. This is the only case in the casebook that deals with false imprisonment. When you're preparing for the exam, you have a long list of torts that you've learned in the intentional torts section, and in your list is the tort of false imprisonment. So now, what's the case going to be about? What is the doctrine you're supposed to learn? So here's the doctrine you're supposed to learn, and I'm going to read the relevant sort of holding for the technical dimension of it, so to speak. The pivotal question before us in most cases of this character, is whether the evidence shows that there are reasonable grounds for the detention. So they've already decided that given the guy, and I totally agree, what they did amounted to a restriction of his freedom of movement because he'd be scared to say no, he's blah, 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 blah. Very Warren Courty, so they're close, strongly identifying with the guy as the weak party in the situation. A common law in an action for false imprisonment, the defense of probable cause, as measured by the prudent and cautious man standard, was available to a merchant. In other words, they can detain him if they have probable cause, and even if he wasn't guilty of anything, they're not liable because they didn't do anything wrong when they detained with probable cause. So okay, so then they say, the legislature inserted the words reasonable grounds. Historically, the words reasonable grounds and probable cause have been given the same meaning by the courts. So they say, this is the law. So you're writing down in your brief, this is the background legal rule. And then I hope you write down the defendant's argument. So the defendant's argument is, the defendant's request for instructions in effect state that the proper test is a subjective one, viz. Whether the defendant Goss had an honest and strong suspicion that the plaintiff was committing or attempting to commit larceny. The jury has decided, is going to decide that there was not a reasonable basis. So the jury is going to decide there was no reasonable basis. But before that happened, the defendant, seeing what was coming, almost certainly, had requested a jury instruction that the test should be subjective belief. And it's very plausible that there was subjective belief given the facts. So it would be easy to convince you that given what the guy saw, there was subjective belief that there had in fact been a shoplifting. And then the court rejects that. They say that the court holds that jury instruction would not have been a good idea. The jury instruction on the basis of reasonable suspicion or probable cause is totally appropriate, and therefore the verdict of $12,500 is upheld. A victory for the little guy in a Warren Cordish context. So the doctrine that you'd write down is what the test is for false imprisonment in shoplifting cases. But that's not all there is, because the court offers a reason why that's the right outcome, a policy reason, so to speak, a non-technical reason, which is the following. If we adopt the subjective test as suggested by the defendants, the individual's right to liberty and freedom of movement would become subject to the, quote, honest suspicion, unquote, of a shopkeeper based on his own, quote, inarticulate hunches without regard to any discernible facts. In effect, the result would be to afford the merchant even greater authority than that given to a police officer. Now, those key words are from Warren Court criminal law opinions about arrest. I can't remember the name of the cases, but the inarticulate hunch, that old business, that rang totally true from, I can't remember what the Supreme Court case is, but there are famous Warren Court phrases about how police officers shouldn't have discretion to make arrests on the basis of inarticulate hunches. Some criminal procedure student should say, wait a minute, here's the case, but I can't remember what it is. So that's a policy reason. That's a reason. It's a rights-based explanation of why a subjective rule would be bad and an objective test is good. So it's not just learning the doctrine. You're also learning a way of arguing in favor of one rule rather than another, that in these subjective things, the objective one is protective of the plaintiff and the subjective one is protective of the defendant, and you're supposed to learn to argue that in terms of rights. Some rights are going to get more and some rights will get less. So it's not just deduction or just doctrine for doctrine, there's a reason offered for it. There's one other hint, which is a casebook note. The note is one sentence. So Epstein has put it in a single sentence right after the opinion, which is supposed to make the student think about another question but doesn't articulate it, though many of our colleagues would, I suspect, teaching this case, pick up on the note and exploit it. So the note says, in cases of false arrest, this is absolute, what justification is there for making an innocent plaintiff bear the costs of the defendant's reasonable mistake? In other words, there's another alternative besides the subjective test and the reasonable suspicion test. The other would be strict liability for mistaken arrest of a shopkeeper. So that no matter how good reason you had to believe, even if you were totally reasonable, if you were mistaken, then the shopkeeper should be able to recover damages if the shopkeeper has a heart attack. And what Epstein is suggesting is you ought to have a policy reason for that too, for that distinction. Now, it is common in our context to do, that is an invitation to a law and economics analysis. It's also rooted in Epstein's belief in strict liability, which is irrelevant, which you would need to know to fully understand the context of the casebook. But a natural response to that would be something like this. So here's thinking about that. What would happen if we had strict liability for mistaken apprehension of the shopkeeper, well, what would happen is it would increase the costs of the retailer. So the retailer is now going to have a choice between paying damages in mistaken cases or reducing the level of surveillance and letting more shopkeepers get away with it. And in either case, that will increase their costs, and they'll pass that cost along to the customers. So a recent basic factor here against the strict liability would be it's actually a conflict not between the store owner and the customer, but between this customer, the victim of a mistaken apprehension, and the rest of the customers who will have to pay more for increasing the level of protection. Okay, so that's a class. So now the critique of the class. That's a class which is totally innocent, that is, sure, absolutely. I actually sort of like the way the analytics unfold, particularly ending up with a little smidgen of economic analysis, which suggests to you that basically trying to protect people is really bad because it's going to pass the costs on to the public in general. So it would be very good not to go into this bleeding heart 70-year-old guys. Let them die on the sidewalk rather than increasing the cost of top coats to you and me. So it has a style of intervention which is familiar. And it's also teaching you to be hard-nosed, and it's teaching you an important thing, to look who's going to pay. It's really, really good to ask who's going to have to pay for this protection. That's not bad. That's law and economics at its absolute best. Here's the criticism. Now, I'm going to do this slightly anecdotally. So this is a real case, a real case book. I taught it for many years. My attitude to it was affected by the following. When I was teaching contracts as a young guy, not 7 years old, in 1975 or 1976, a student of mine became a clerk in the Massachusetts trial court. In East Cambridge, the very beautiful Bullfinch building. And he demanded, he said, you don't know anything about, you've never practiced law, you know absolutely nothing about it. I demand that you come and observe a trial. So I actually complied. The building was incredibly beautiful. The trial was a civil action by a black woman, an African-American woman, against one of the stores in Central Square for falsely apprehending her as a shoplifter. So she sued for damages. I didn't sit through the whole trial. A jury had been impaneled, but I heard the end of her testimony on direct, in which her lawyer asked her the following question. This is really inconvenient for you. It's obviously been a horrible experience. I didn't actually get, I don't know whether she had a heart attack, but I didn't get the full description of why she was so particularly injured that her lawyer thought he could get enough damages to make the contingency fee worth it. And she said, look, this happens to us all the time. It is absolutely constant. You go into a store and you're constantly being hassled, you're constantly being basically looked at with suspicion, and you're constantly being accused of shoplifting, and I'm just sick of it. That's why I sue. So, okay, I get Epstein's casebook, so I'm prepared by this random event, a benefit of never having practiced law and being subject to the mockery of your students as a rank amateur who have not even a member of the bar. Please let me come just look and see what it's like. Have you ever seen a judge? So this is the source of this little moment of teaching. Now, it then looks as though the choice between the reasonable person standard and strict liability has a little more significance. It's obvious that the reasonable person standard is going to be heavily subject to social stereotyping, context, and all the factors that Kim was talking about. Totally subject to that. The guy is going to claim, and if the jury is a white jury, they will be strongly influenced by racial stereotypes about shoplifting and theft. Very strongly influenced by that. It's a very weak standard of protection in a situation of strong racial prejudice, first. So the argument for strict liability is different from the argument of strict liability as I originally posed it, because strict liability looks like a plausible way to respond to the racist application of a reasonable person standard, first. So that's the first point. This case taught this way actually is quite different in what it's about. It's about how much protection actually, given the prevalence of this racial structure to the store encounter. And by the way, it's not just a poor or lower middle class. There's a very famous article by Patricia Williams, who I'm sure you've all heard of Shopping While Black. It's a brilliant description of shopping on Madison Avenue in high fashion stores and approaching the store and hearing the click of the lock that will then require her to request entry because she's black. So she walks down the street, she wants to go look at a Balenciaga dress, her favorite thing, and then there's this click, and then she has to pick up the phone or do the intercom in order to get into the store. So this is not just a class issue, it's a race issue across class. So now let's talk about the economic argument. So this is the last part. So there's a distributive question, that is, the black plaintiffs have an argument that they're underprotected, that they should get more. What about the argument that it's expense of fellow shoppers? So here would be a simple distributive way of looking at it, which is not liberal. It's distributively oriented from a more left-wing point of view, and it would go like this. The people who are going to benefit are not customers in general. A rule of strict liability is, in effect, an insurance policy. It's an insurance policy for black shoppers against the harm of being falsely accused of shoplifting. Think of it as just an insurance policy. You pay for it by paying more for the goods. But the distributive argument is this. The price of the goods will be uniformly raised for everybody by a tiny amount, but the benefits will be concentrated on a particular class, not only concentrated only on a particular class, but a disproportionate number of the people who recover will be African American. So this is, in fact, a distributive legal rule. If you have strict liability, a very small increase in price that's imposed on everybody will substantially benefit the class of people who are being discriminated against in the application of suspicion by shoplifters and the reasonable person standard. So the basic argument is the case. Now, how many cases are there like this in the first year curriculum? Millions. Millions. They are everywhere. So every casebook has in the list of defenses the privilege, official privilege. What is official privilege? It's not a battery if you are a police officer when you arrest someone. From that, you just have a whole segment on police brutality. So police brutality is built into the torts course that way. There's a defense of self-defense. Big question, does the battered woman have the right to kill in self-defense? You can teach the whole torts case having the race or gender dimension of every single case. That's all I have to say. Now let me say my last case. It's so fun to do my last case in this context as a last actual exercise of Harvard Law School teaching. And it's really been a great ride. I'm very glad and thank you for listening to it.
It's a point of pride for me. I mean, it's just personal for me, and I just want to share it with you that I graduated from Harvard Law School. I became a scholar. I have returned here several times, but only at the invitation of the students and never at the invitation of the institution or the faculty. So thank you. So I want to talk about, I want to basically pick up, and I hope this follows well from what you've heard, the idea of a kind of mock class where we model how to teach and everything. The point I want to describe would take a couple of months in my class to get to, and usually I try to joke around and charm the class and get a certain kind of credibility and stuff before I ask people to participate. So I'm not going to ask you to participate. But also, obviously, it's not our model of teaching to not let you talk. Okay, so I just want to get that out. I hope there are that we do have time for exchange. But what I'm going to try to do is just explain what I do as a teacher, what I'm thinking about, and how it's political, I think, and what I'm trying to accomplish, as opposed to kind of do it. Okay, I'm going to talk about it as opposed to do it, and. these are the connections I want to make. So this morning, there was a lot of mention of Harvard Law School and the issue of meritocracy. And I want to talk about that more tomorrow. But I think that the biggest claim of meritocracy at any law school, but particularly Harvard Law School, I guess, is the claim that law schools teach a rule of law, a law that is distinct from politics. So that's kind of my starting point. And just as I have a will to delegitimate the meritocracy that has said that the people that I grew up with, that my forebears, that my grandmother and grandparents were not fit to have a decent wage and to receive the respect and prestige of other citizens in the society, I have a will to deconstruct and to critique the rule of law too, which I think sends the same message, that our basic distribution of wealth, power, and prestige is legal, is, you know, it matches up with a distinction between law and politics. It's neutral and objective in some way. Okay, so that's my starting point. My image is that law is a language or a discourse that represents to us what our lives are like. It represents transactions. People are contracting parties or they're tortfeasors. The difference between legal discourse in a novel or songs or politics is the claim to be neutral, to be above the fray. And so what I'm responding to is the manner in which law works as an ideology to convince us that this is neutral, that there is a distinction between law and politics, and more than just kind of convince us as an ideology that we might adopt, actually help to constitute our own experience of what the world is like, of how we see it and how we experience it. So the particular connection I want to make is between the affirmative action issues that Kim talked about and the private law. I'm going to talk about the case of Williams v. Walker Thomas, which I assume everybody is familiar with. Anyway, back to the connection. So the connection I want to draw is between affirmative action for race, so-called special rights for gays and lesbians. This is the Scalia rejection of special rights in the constitutional cases, the connection between that and the doctrine of unconscionability. So I want to present to you my thesis that unconscionability is affirmative action in private law. It's the particular claim that if you just apply the normal rules, Mrs. Williams, the single black mother on general relief in the case, loses. And that we only need kind of special pleading, look at her special situation, see that she's not really able to function in the market the way other people function. That's the justification for unconscionability, for making an exception to the general rules, just like the justification for affirmative action tends to be a similar kind of claim of the incapacity of the beneficiary. We need affirmative action to achieve diversity in our institutions, or we need affirmative action for fairness because some disempowered members haven't had the same training and chances, and they need a kind of leg up. I find in either private law or in the affirmative action context, these are humiliating messages and humiliating discourse by which we have to try to achieve crumbs from the ruling class. So what I'm motivated to do is to break it down and ask, what is the baseline? This is very, you know, I think it matches up very similarly with what Kim did. What is the baseline from which this special right has to be recognized? So that's what I'm trying to do. I'm trying to identify and break down the baseline that makes it appear that there is a neutral meritocracy. Obviously, that's the word in the affirmative action context. Or some kind of neutral market relations that people need special dispensation from in the affirmative action or unconscionability frame. I want to say one word about context here. Well, let me just get into the case. So about context, I'm trying to teach the ideological context, and I'm trying to break it down and challenge the claim that there is something different from the in legal reasoning and what gets taught in law schools and what gets valorized as neutral and objective compared to politics, that there's something different from that than regular old politics that we're used to. The status quo is not spiritualized by something deeper than the normal give and take of politics. So this is ideological context that that I hope to teach. Context. And so the idea of context, is, you know, as I'm sure you all know, was first introduced by the legal realists in mainstream legal thought as a way to answer the formalism of the classical period, just looking at contracting parties in terms of offer and acceptance and not looking to the context in which, say, business people transacted. So you make the UCC adapt to the context of business people. But context can be a little tricky, as the Williams v. Walker Thomas case demonstrates. So this is not a case where some of y'all have mentioned the erasure of race, where race is just never mentioned. This is the exceptional case where everybody knows. I mean, some teachers may be too uncomfortable to say the word, but everybody knows this case is about race. And then the question is, how is it constructed and dealt with? The basic case, as you know, comes out for Ms. Williams on the ground that there was unconscionability, and a big part of the unconscionability has these two aspects to it. And if I was teaching you torts and contracts, I would go through them, but I'm not going to. So a big part of the case is the procedural unconscionability of a cross-collateralization provision. How could she possibly know a poor black woman on welfare in Washington, D.C.? How could she possibly understand cross-collateralization, this complex economic concept by which I assume everyone became familiar with it when you read the case, by which in a rent-to-own transaction, you might get a whole mess of furniture, but each payment is prorated over every piece of furniture, so you never end up owning everything. I mean, you never end up owning anything until you own everything. You miss a payment like she did along the way, and you lose it all. It's all repossessed, and any equity you might have achieved were this a sales transaction to own some of the pieces is gone. That's the nature of cross-collateralization. Okay, so the liberal, the American law has some liberal aspects to it. The liberal approach is, well, let's make an exception. Let's do it, again, I call it affirmative action. Let's make an exception here. Let's look at the context. The context is this is a poor, unsophisticated, disempowered woman, and therefore, there's no way that she really understood what she was doing, and that will be our ground for the unconscionability doctrine. By the way, I don't want to be mistaken. I'm for the unconscionability doctrine. This will lead, this is going to lead to an argument that the criticism of the unconscionability doctrine is unfounded analytically. It's not, it can't, it's indefensible. Okay, so how could she possibly understand? Well, that's the context that's added to the normal formal story. A contracting party had offered an acceptance consideration. She agreed to this. So we're going to make an exception because of the context. But context is a tricky thing. As I see the context, I don't buy the non-disclosure problem. I don't buy that she doesn't know what she was doing, because I know what it's like to live in compacted, high-density, low-income apartment buildings or housing projects where she knows very well what happened. It's happened to her neighbors over and over again. Everybody in the complex knows. Sometimes violence erupts when the repossessors come to get the furniture. It's a dramatic moment, just like an eviction is in these neighborhoods. She knows. The liberal construct to respond to the disempowerment with a claim of disclosure. Non-disclosure is the problem. We just need to get all the terms out there and make sure everybody understands. That's contextualization. But it's a false contextualization. It's misrepresenting the story. I might be exaggerating this a little bit for the point I'm trying to make, but the point I'm trying to make is if you add that context, people do understand. She's got no defense under the unconscionability doctrine. Well, the unconscionability doctrine is then understood to be an intervention into the market. The market worked a certain way, but because we didn't like the result, we're going to do special affirmative action and intervene in the market, again, because she didn't understand and the substantive part and the deal was so bad. And then subject to the standard critiques that one hears, the most, including by liberals. And so the kind of sharpest critique, I think, is the paternalism critique. And Arthur Leff made this right after the decision was made in a Law Review article. He said, what you're basically doing is telling poor people that they can't buy any frills. One of the items was a stereo, I think. They can't buy any luxury items or any frills. You're trying to impose middle class values on a poor black woman. The race aspect here contextualizes to jazz up the paternalism problem. It's even worse. You're racist and paternalist is the normal message. And to the extent that this is the framework of the case, what special intervention do we need to make? We would need to do something off of the market, something different, something to compensate for the failures of the market. Okay, that's very similar to the affirmative action case. So I want to propose, and I would do this over the course of several classes, a different way of looking at the case that examines the baseline in which the parties find themselves and asks, is unconscionability the intervention or is something else the intervention? And you can only do this, I guess there's different ways to do it, but I only understand how to do it by understanding the private law system as a system where torts, you have to understand torts, you have to understand property, you have to understand contract, it all fits together to make up individuals' power in the market. Okay, so what exactly did the Walker Thomas Furniture Company do? They lent someone money, basically. They extended credit to rent to own this furniture to someone who was likely to be unable to pay it back properly. And that's why they, as a business matter, need that cross-collateralization provision. You need higher security if you've got a bigger credit risk. I understand that. And that's completely understandable. But let me just put this in different terms. So it was reasonably foreseeable to Walker Thomas that by engaging in this cross-collateralization transaction with Ms. Williams, that she would likely suffer loss, injury, the stripping, as I said, of her equity, that she would suffer and be harmed from that. Well, that statement of it, I don't know if everybody had the same experience in torts that I did, but once I learned the standard of negligence, it's everywhere. Everybody, let's sue! That's what I'm appealing to. So this is negligence. This is the standard of negligence. They have failed to use reasonable care to prevent injury to another party. Why doesn't Ms. Williams have a claim for negligence? Why does she have to go to unconscionability? There's a real easy answer to it. It's a doctrinal answer, and it would be the correct answer if I asked this. And it's the economic loss rule. There's a particular rule that says that if your unreasonable conduct that breaches what otherwise would be the standard of care in the situation causes exclusively economic harm, then there's no liability. It's the economic loss rule. It's damnum ob obscurium or something, you know what I mean? You injure, but nobody worries about it, you don't have to pay. So it's in that region. But arguably, it's a prima facie case of negligence, and the person who's the beneficiary, the party, who's the beneficiary of the affirmative action, is the party who gets the privilege of the economic loss doctrine. Under the baseline, as I've described it, they have committed a tort against Ms. Williams, and they should owe her compensation for wrongfully injuring her. That tort doesn't apply because that harm has been privileged by the law of the economic loss doctrine. They are privileged to cause harm without having to pay compensation, just like that boat in that dock case that you all might have read in first year on for the necessity doctrine, right? It's a privilege that's been created. Most privileges to cause harm are created because in the famous Holmes formulation where he asked why is one business party privileged to cause economic harm to a competitor, to another? Well, the answer is because competition is a social benefit. And so there we have it. We have back down to the question, if that's the question, if we frame it that way, we're not asking, is this woman so incompetent that she can't participate in the market? We're not framing it as affirmative action. were demonstrating that the starting point of their transactions has already been intervened in through an affirmative action doctrine. That's called privilege, the economic loss rule in this context. It may be, as a practical matter, if you took away the privilege, the economic loss rule privilege, that maybe she would contract away these rights, and we would then face what should we make this this non-disclaimable, et cetera. But what I'm saying is the ideological message would be vastly different. It wouldn't be that Ms. Williams failed in a fair, neutral, objective market, and now we have to make special contextual exceptions because of her failure. It would be an understanding that her situation and the furniture store situation is constituted by the legal rules that give them exposure and entitlements, that exposes them to privileges and gives them certain entitlements. And it's the mix of these privileges and entitlements that goes into everyone's bargaining power. So the claim that the various claims that are made all depend on a failure to see this analytic point. And I think it's just an analytic point. I don't think you need to be a leftist or, you know, have particular sympathies on any side here. This is just the analytic point. What is the starting point here for understanding these parties' relationship? It may be that the defense of unconscionability, or if you got rid of the economic loss rule, picking up now on Duncan's example, that would raise the cost of credit. People won't be able to get these stereos. This is the law and economics distribution argument. You're hurting the very people you're trying to help, you bleeding heart liberal lunatics. And I just want to give a quick response to that, an analytic response. One part of it is that it's correct. Yes, when you raise the cost, you probably do curtail the supply, subject to an amazingly complex argument presented by Duncan Kennedy and some others that the distributive effects of such are very complex, depends on the context, situation, supply curves. The graph got a little fuzzy for me, Duncan. But it's a very complex argument what the distributive result will be. I'm not really talking about that part. What I'm talking about is, what do you mean that it will cut down the supply? Do you mean that there was a natural supply, some natural level of predatory lending, and that this is distorting the market for predatory lending? But that is what they mean. That is what they mean. Because we all know that there'd be a lot more stereos to get if instead of having to go through this cross-collateralization business, which requires, you know, you got to hire people to repossess the stuff, that's not a good job. Anyway, I don't want to get into all that. But it's very unseemly. I'll just leave it at that. Wouldn't it be easier if you could just call the sheriff to put your debtor in jail? Wouldn't that cut down the risk of extending credit to somebody who might not be able to pay? If you could just put him in jail. You're not getting this. Shoot them. Okay, that'll make people pay. You'll be the first creditor paid. It will reduce the cost of these goods and services. It will reduce the cost of default to the creditor. Shoot them. The point of shooting them is that a regime in which we shoot the debtors would not be more natural, wouldn't be fairer, and it certainly wouldn't be one that was free from the intervention of the regulatory hand of the unconscionability doctrine. But that's the logic of the argument about supply. So yeah, it's a fundamental political argument. Exactly what kind of supply you're going to end up having based on what conditions you're going to put with respect to the relationship between creditors and debtors. What I'm suggesting is that the baseline that actually gives the creditor the privilege is hidden from view in an invisible ideological invitation to you to believe the dominant message that American society is basically fair and just. We need a little tweaking, that's what unconscionability is for, and that's what affirmative action is for. I don't believe it. I think the distribution of wealth, power, and prestige is fundamentally unjust, and it's unjust for virtually everyone in our society. And that's why I try to do the ideological context deconstruction that I try to do when I teach these classes.
All right. Well, thank you so much for having me here today for this panel on law and social context. My name is Aziza Ahmed, and I'm an associate professor of law at Northeastern University School of Law in Boston. And I've been teaching there for about 5 years, and prior to that, I've been doing a lot of activism and work with different NGOs in public health, primarily. I teach property, sexual and reproductive health and rights, and international health. I won't talk about this today, but it really inspires us to do creative and interesting things. So, for example, in my property class, I mean, some of my property students are here, actually, at Northeastern. This year, we started the class with Tennessee Coates, the case for reparations, because, you know, I want the students to know from the get-go, from day one, that race and class structure access to property, and property has this distributional effect on race and class. And last year we started by talking about the Trayvon Martin case and how the Trayvon Martin case in some ways is a property case. It's about who belongs where and who's entitled to belong where. So this is a unique dynamic, I think, what we're doing here today. And I think just to acknowledge that for law professors also, as well as students, I think we're all constantly up against this giant world where the rules are the only thing that matter. And this is, of course, inspired in part by the bar exam, but also, you know, other sort of things that are going on, like annoying law blogs for students, which sort of push people, I think, in a more conservative direction, unfortunately. So, needless to say, I think what's happening here is really important, and I'm really happy to be a part of it. So, I followed my instructions carefully. So, I'm going to present to you a case in a non-contextualized way, and then tell you a little bit about the story of the case. And then finally do what I try to do when I teach, which is connect some of the issues from the case to our contemporary moment, so what's happening today and what's happening around us. So as I mentioned, I teach and research in several areas, one of which is health law and sexual and reproductive health and rights. And the case I was going to talk to you about today is Buck versus Bell. It's also taught in common law by some people. And I thought I would use it, especially because it's a very explicit case about gender and reproduction, and I thought it would help bring some of those issues onto the table. And finally, something I'm very interested in, and I think a lot of people are interested in, is the sort of authority that law and science and the legitimating power of law and science in sort of maintaining certain ideas. And so this is a case that's a very good example of that. So what is Buck versus Bell? I checked with Rena. I know that a lot of people probably haven't read the case yet, but it's a two-page decision. Short decision. It was written by Holmes, but it's an important case. And basically, it found, and this is how you would learn it if you were learning it in a decontextualized way in a law school, in a sort of health law context, let's say. It found that the Virginia sterilization law was constitutional because sterilization of the feeble-minded for the health, it was okay as long as it was for the health of the patient or the welfare of society, and it did not violate due process because one actually has a hearing to determine whether or not they should be sterilized, even if the recommendation of sterilization had already occurred. The case reinforced a decision, the holding of an older case called Jacobson versus Massachusetts, which found that the state had the authority to enact compulsory vaccination laws. Buck versus Bell was never overturned. It's still good law. And if you go to Westlaw, you'll see that there's been 2003 citations to the case since then. And most importantly, perhaps, the case was cited in Roe versus Wade, the landmark abortion decision that I'm sure you're all familiar with, when clarifying that the right to privacy was, in fact, not absolute. And so the majority says, at some point in pregnancy, these respective interests become sufficiently compelling to sustain regulation of the factors that govern the abortion decision. The privacy right involved, therefore, cannot be said to be absolute. In fact, it is not clear to us that the claim asserted by some that one has an unlimited right to do with one's body as one pleases bears a close relationship to the right of privacy previously articulated in the court's decisions. The court has refused to recognize an unlimited right of this kind in the past, and they cite, again, to Jacobson versus Massachusetts and Buck versus Bell. Now, once you know this line of cases, and maybe that's all that's been presented to you, you can then proceed to have a conversation about contemporary public health issues. So, for example, and these would be without political context, so, for example, should people be with Ebola be mandated to, should they be compelled to submit to quarantine? Or you might have a discussion that's going on all the time right now, should parents be forced to vaccinate their child given a measles outbreak, right? And when one is sometimes balancing these oppositional rights involved with quarantine or measles, what disappears into the background are the political and social issues in which these questions are embedded in and will impact. So we often forget to ask, how will our answers distribute resources unevenly? Who benefits? Who loses? Are the people who benefit all of one race? Are they largely rich? Who might find this or experiences this as coercive and why? This begs the question of what we might put into context with Buck versus Bell. And revisiting Buck in context allows us to see that what seems like a simple interrogation into conflicting considerations, and I'm using Duncan's terminology here, might in fact lead to gross injustice, that the legal rules will actually distribute certain resources and realities differently. So who was Carrie Buck? I'll tell you a little bit about her before we circle back to the current day. This is the famous quote from the decision that three generations of imbeciles are enough. Carrie Buck was the daughter of Emma Buck, the widowed mother of three small children. She supported her children through prostitution and charity. They were finally taken from her. Three-year-old Carrie Buck, Emma's daughter, went to live with J.T. and Alice Dobbs. Carrie progressed normally through 5 years of school before she was taken out so that she could engage in more household responsibilities. And the Dobbs were satisfied with Carrie until she turned about 17 years old and accused the Dobbs son of raping her. A Binet-Simon IQ test, which is, of course, the precursor to the many IQ tests still in existence today, including the Stanford Binet test, which you can go online and take at your pleasure, revealed that Carrie's mental age was 9, and soon Carrie's baby was born, and the Dobbs had Carrie committed to the colony for the epileptic and feeble-minded in 1924, where Carrie's mother had also been committed previously. Now, once they decided that Carrie had inherited feeble-mindedness from her mother and that the baby had inherited the same illness, there was a physician, Dr. Pretty, who's up on the screen here. He thought that Carrie would be the perfect test case for the Virginia sterilization law, and this was because she was feeble-minded as well as a moral delinquent. So he said that she had a record of immorality, prostitution, untruthfulness, and syphilis. He described the Bucks generally as people who belong to a shiftless, ignorant, and worthless class of antisocial whites from the South. And of course, this case eventually set the stage for the thousands of sterilizations that occurred in the United States after that. So there's one complicating factor here, of course, and that is that Carrie Buck was not feeble-minded, as it came out much later when she was sort of once again discovered in the 1980s, and that her daughter, until she died, did fine in school. So this raises some important questions about why it is that, you know, we are talking about this case in the way that we are, and why it is, in particular, that the court felt that it was a legitimate decision to make, given this kind of evidence to the contrary. So what we need to know to understand this is that it's 1927, and this is, of course, the high point of the eugenics movement. Eugenics, which was an offshoot of genetic science, asserted that we should encourage reproduction among individuals who reproduce better traits, like intelligence, skin color, good looks, etc. Here are some slides from the eugenics archive. So, you know, you have the some people are born to be a burden on the rest, and this is the eugenics building, and you can't really read the sign in the back, but there's a award for the fittest family. And here's Fitter Families of Georgia, which is at a fair, and then the American Eugenics Society in the 1920s had a traveling display. And you can kind of see that they do these, I can't tell if that's with gerbils, but they do this race-mixing gerbil demonstration on some of the slides. Now this is, of course, a very racialized thing, and this is the scene from Django Unchained, which probably many of you have seen. Have you guys all seen this movie? Okay, so this is the scene when Leonardo DiCaprio is actually explaining racial science, and he has the skull of presumably a black person, and is explaining why the, you know, makeup of the skull actually is an indication of how black people are less intelligent than white people. And you might watch that movie and think, oh, you know, only racist fools thought that. That's, you know, not something that people really thought about. But of course, this wasn't fringe science. It came out of what was understood at the time to be rigorous data gathering and was a product of Enlightenment thinking. And it came from important institutions, one that you might be familiar with called Harvard, which legitimated race science, but also helped Harvard lead as an institution studying race during this time. And one of the, I mean, there's so many people that you can pick on, but, you know, one of the very important figures is Agassiz, who was alive in the early 1800s. He was a zoologist here at Harvard for some of his career, and one is considered one of the most important American scientists. And you know, he said, for example, we ought to be beware of how we give to the blacks rights by virtue of which they may endanger the progress of whites. Social equality, I deem at all times impractical. It is natural. It is a natural impossibility flowing from the very character of the Negro race. They are incapable of living on a footing of social equality with the whites in one and the same community without becoming an element of social disorder. And instead of a picture of him, I thought I would just point you all to Agassiz Street here in Cambridge, which intersects with Linnaeus Street, which is also you know, one of our racial science forefathers here. Okay, and then here's just another quote because I couldn't resist. Let me see if I can read it from here. Which says that the government ought to put every possible obstacle to the crossings of races and the increase of half-breeds. It is immoral and destructive of social equality as it creates unnatural relations and multiplies the differences among the members of the same community in the wrong direction. Now, what's kind of distressing actually about Googling Agassiz is that you get all the places that are named after him in Cambridge. So here's a preschool, which I also couldn't resist putting on there. Here's just another. Now, what brought the end of this? Well, the Virginia Sterilization Act, as well as mainly the Eugenics Act that it was based on, as well as the California Eugenics Act, basically were the precursor laws to what Nazi Germany used when they decided to enact a sterilization law. And with the Holocaust came the decline of racial science. And, you know, racial science basically lost its legitimacy. So we weren't allowed to talk about race in the same way. Now, this, of course, did not go away, and the legacy of this time is still with us. And the question that we keep asking today, I think, and I'll just reflect on that for the last minute or two of this presentation, is, you know, the question that we keep asking, you know, whose lives are worth reproducing, whose lives are worthy of living, and, you know, some lives are even worthy of experimenting on. Here is a picture of the Tuskegee trials that took place in Tuskegee, Alabama, where, you know, 399 men with syphilis, 600 men total, were followed for many years. They thought they were being treated for syphilis from 1930 to 1970, but in fact they were not being treated. And of course, you know, the way the racial science started to work, it started to sort of shape, take new shape. And some sociologists have pointed out is there's an interesting politics of difference and inclusion here, because of course we want to see some people's bodies as different, we want to see some lives as less worthy, but at the same time, while we kind of reinforce the politics of difference all the time, we are quite capable and happy to experiment on black people's bodies in this time period. And you know, today, depending on how we think about some of these ethical issues surrounding research, but we can extrapolate those findings. The people are same enough that you can extrapolate those findings to white bodies or to other bodies. There's obviously the direct, and these are just really kind of things I picked out. There's a million different examples one could use. A direct continuation of the logic of Buck, and this was, and I have this up here as sort of a representation of the early 1990s period in which Norplant was given as a condition for probation for women who were found to be guilty of child abuse and neglect. And of course, this disproportionately impacted minority women. And then the issue of sterilization, of course, which has also not disappeared. And you know, just to highlight too, the California prison case that just came out in which a couple hundred women were sterilized, 150 women were sterilized without their consent between 2006 and 2010. And the North Carolina sterilizations that now people are trying to seek some compensation for that occurred between 1929 and 1974. So, you know, I think what we see when we're kind of living in our current moment is a continuation of these very questions, right? They challenge the basic reading of Buck versus Bell. They call on the same questions that we've been asking for a long time. You know, whose lives are worth protecting? Which communities of people should flourish? Who should not flourish? And which bodies, and I think Teju Cole has a really nice piece in The New Yorker about this, sort of our unmournable bodies. You know, who are the people who are worthy of living? Well, and I'll stop there.